Welcome to Learn the Sky, your online resource for learning about the stars and constellations.
Welcome, my name is Janine, and in this video, we're going to celebrate and discuss the landing of the Mars Perseverance 2020 rover on the surface of Mars in Jezero Crater. This is very exciting because there are so many different technologies that are going to be tested on this particular mission. And even though this is a departure from my typical videos about stars and constellations, the planets are still observable objects in the sky, and I personally love learning about them. So let's get started. The Mars 2020 rover blasted off into space this past July of 2020. And even though that happened 7 months ago, this mission has been well in the works for over a decade. So after it launched, it went into the cruise part of this mission, and it took 7 months for Mars Perseverance to reach Mars. And on February 18th, it entered the entry, descent, and landing portion of this mission. And this is what NASA scientists call the 7 minutes of terror, because anything can happen during this time. And Mars Perseverance was scheduled to land in Jezero Crater. What's interesting about the Jezero Crater is that it was once a standing body of water. And when we study Mars, we have to follow the water. Where was water once existed? And in this particular mission, what I find really interesting is that they're going to be collecting samples of the Martian terrain that will eventually be returned to Earth. And my favorite part of this entry, descent, and landing is the sky crane maneuver. And this maneuver was used before on the Curiosity mission. There are no longer any bouncing rovers. The bouncing rovers was something I love seeing animations of with Spirit and Opportunity, but now the sky crane maneuver is being used. So it's very, very exciting that this is where we're at. We had our first successful pictures from the Perseverance mission. So the surface mission is broken down into different parts. The first is that they're going to be collecting these core samples about the size of a piece of chalk, and we're going to collect this box of rocks and eventually return it to Earth where we can study it in more detail. Because in reality, we're not really able to take large sophisticated equipment to Mars. We have to make it compact, we have to make it sturdy and fit on something the size of a Mini Cooper. And that's how big Mars Perseverance is, about the size of a Mini Cooper. And on February 18th, we saw the first picture from Perseverance. It's a little grainy, but that's mostly because of the dust that was kicked up as it landed on the surface. Another exciting piece of this journey is that there will be a helicopter on Perseverance, and this will be doing some scouting and collecting some data that is needed for scientists. And this is just a precursor for many other missions. So when humans eventually travel to Mars, it will be important to have helicopters like these to travel around and scout out different areas before humans even go there. And there really are some challenges with creating a helicopter that can work on Mars, because the atmospheric pressure is just so different. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. So anything that I talk about on Mars, I'm always going to reference what is on the NASA Mars 2020 website, which I'm going to put a link for that in the information below so you can check it out, because really I'm not going to recreate what NASA does. They do an incredible job putting information out there for the general public to view. So definitely check that out. And I just have to give a shout out to all the scientists out there that were a part of this mission. There really were thousands of people that helped put this together. And in the middle of a pandemic, right towards launch period is when the pandemic happened, and these wonderful people were able to get everything done that they needed to get done. And it really is inspiring. So we really are just at the start now of the surface mission. So it's going to be exciting to see what comes out of it over the course of time. So in the next portion of this video, what I want to go over with you is just some basics about Mars and where exactly it is in the sky in the time that this video was made in February of 2021. At the time of this recording, the best way to find Mars is to look for the Pleiades and also follow the moon. So you really have to know where to find Taurus. Taurus is where the Pleiades star cluster is located, and this is where Mars is in relation to the Pleiades. So hopefully if you have clear skies, you're able to find it. I do have an upcoming video on the Pleiades, and I have a video about Taurus, so be sure to go see that video. But I'd like to share just some broad facts about Mars. Mars is a planet that is half the size of Earth, and it's known as the fourth planet from the sun. It got its name from the Roman god of war. And Mars is interesting because even though it's half the size of Earth, there are some similarities there. It has an axial tilt of 25 degrees, which is similar to what the axial tilt of the Earth is. Earth's axial tilt is 23.5 degrees. So the fact that it has this tilt, it has seasons just like Earth does. Its atmosphere is primarily made of carbon dioxide, and the very big difference between Mars and Earth is that Mars has no magnetic field. So this poses some challenges for when humans eventually land on Mars. The fact that there's a carbon dioxide atmosphere, so we're either going to have to take our oxygen with us or find a way to create oxygen, but there's also no magnetic field. Another challenge is that since Earth is smaller, it has less, or I'm sorry, since Mars is smaller, it has less gravity. So that's one of the reasons it's not able to hold those heavier elements like oxygen and nitrogen like Earth has. Also, it is estimated that water has existed in the past on Mars. Scientists have found features that are very similar to what we found on Earth that suggest water was present. But until we collect those samples from Mars, which will really be happening, it won't be happening for quite a few years, that we really need to look at detailed analysis of the soil to see if there was once water there and if there are any biosignatures there. I also think a little fun fact is that the largest volcano in the solar system is located on Mars. It's called Olympus Mons, and it does have two moons that were once captured asteroids called Phobos and Deimos. In the next portion of this video, I want to provide you with some strategies with how to view Mars and the other planets. So as you take a look at this photo, what stands out to you? For me, there's about three things that stand out. First is definitely the Milky Way, which is right here. It takes up a large portion of this photo. And then there are a few meteors that are traveling through this photo as well. But the final thing right here is this planet, which is Mars. And how do I know? It's because of its reddish color. You'll also notice that the motion of the planets are different than that of the stars. The stars have a predictable, regular motion, and we know when we go out at this particular time that we will see this star at this time of the year. Well, that's different for planets. So in order to understand this, you have to understand the definition of a planet. And the word planet is traced back to the ancient Greeks, which means wandering stars. And they named it that because the motion of the planets didn't follow that of the stars. We would see that they would move backwards in the sky, and then they would move forwards, and then it would go backwards again. And this plotting here of Mars really is happening over the course of many months. So it's important to understand that, and that planets got their names from wandering stars. So the other thing that I want you to notice is that this is very bright when you compare it to all the other stars. The apparent magnitude of Mars is -2.9, and the apparent magnitude of the brightest star, Sirius, is -1.5. So Mars is always going to be brighter than all the other stars, and it's going to have that reddish tint. If we were to zoom in on Mars using a telescope, this is what it would look like. And if you have any questions about apparent magnitude or absolute magnitude, I have a video on that, so be sure to go check out that video. But this picture here shows you what Mars would look like through a telescope. And what's interesting is you can see different colors here. You can also see one of the ice caps here. So it's really amazing to look at Mars through a telescope. I have had the opportunity to do it, and it never disappoints for sure. And I wanted to show you some other pictures of Mars as well, so you can just get that experience with learning how to recognize it. So I'm sure you can find it in this photo. Here we have a picture of a comet, and then you have this picture right here of Mars near the comet, which is really, really fascinating. And you can clearly see that that is a disk in the sky. If we get some more practice here, here's another photo. So here you're actually looking at two planets. So are you able to tell which one is Mars? I can, because Mars always has that reddish color. And remember, the Martian soil is reddish in color because of iron being oxidized. So that tells us that oxygen was probably present at some point in the history of Mars. But Mars is located right here, and then this other planet is Jupiter. So I like this picture because it shows the magnitude of both objects, and Mars appears to be a little bit brighter. So keep in mind that magnitude can really change also with atmospheric disturbances, but this gives you a good comparison between Mars and Jupiter. I actually have a picture that I took of Mars. This is not a really great quality picture. It was taken with an iPhone, but you can probably point out where Mars is. It's the brightest spot on this photo. Right there. And here is where Capricornus is. I remember when I took this photo, because it was traveling through Capricornus, so I was able to kind of track its progress over the course of many nights. It was really cool. And then over here is where Aquarius is. Very difficult to point out because Aquarius is very faint. I've got a video on that. You should go check it out. Here is another interesting photo of the moon and Mars. And when the moon covers different objects such as planets, we call that an occultation. I don't have any videos on that one, but that will be coming soon. Here we have another picture, and there are two planets in here. And this one can be a little deceiving because I told you that yes, Mars is very bright in the sky, but there's another planet that is always brighter, and that will be Venus. So what we're looking at here is the moon, and then this bright star, or I'm sorry, this bright object is a planet. This is Venus, and this right here is Mars. So I wanted to show you this photo so you know the difference between Venus and Mars. Venus is always brighter. So let's take a look at a couple more pictures here. Okay. Are you able to tell what we're looking at? Okay, you should be able to find the moon, you should be able to find Venus, and you should be able to find Mars. So the moon is obvious, it's the biggest object in this photograph, but then here is Venus and here is Mars. And you can even tell from this picture that Mars has a slightly reddish color to it. So that's what you want to look for when you're trying to find Mars. This concludes my video about the Mars 2020 rover Perseverance. We really have only just started with this mission, so it'll be really exciting to see the kinds of science and data that comes out of this particular mission. And it was great to see a successful landing after over a decade of hard work by many scientists, engineers, technicians, and so on and so forth. They really just did something so amazing, and I'm really, really grateful that we get to benefit from their hard work in the future. I love learning about science, and if you're watching this, I'm sure you do as well. So let me know in the comments, were you able to watch the landing? What was the most exciting part for you? And what kinds of things are you looking forward to learning about Mars with this mission? So as always, it takes time, patience, and practice to study the sky, the stars, the constellations, and of course, the planets. So thank you so much for watching. Remember to go outside and keep looking up. Thank you.